Bismillah walhamdulillah wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. This is part 3 of women and perfume, and it will be the last part inshallah. My dear sisters and my brothers, to recap the whole thing, there is nowhere in Al-Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibits women from wearing perfume. And that is that. So perfume is a beautification that humans love, and any beautification can be sexualized. Any beautification can be a source of attraction, and attraction can, if used properly, lead to seduction, and seduction can lead to sexual activities. And since Allah wants to protect human heritage and progeny, amongst other reasons, He regulated the sexual contact between the two sexes. In the Quran, my dear sisters and my brothers, you will not find a direct command from Allah where He says, "Do not fornicate." But He speaks subhanahu wa ta'ala as in the third party. And this is a very good thing that Allah has done for us, because if He said do not commit fornication, it will be a direct accusation. La tazni, la taznu, do not commit fornication. It will be, and you are not one of these people. So Allah puts it in the third pronoun, wa la yaznun, so that, and they do not fornicate, and He tells you that I love that, I don't want you to fornicate. But He doesn't say I don't want you to fornicate, He says I want the people not to fornicate, do not fornicate, and things like that. So there is the direct command and there is the indirect command. In the indirect command, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us وَلَا يَزْنُونَ, and they do not commit fornication. He didn't say, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la taznu, you who have believed, do not commit zina, or Ya ayyuha alnas, la taznu, or people do not commit zina. Allah did not say that, and that is alhamdulillah, where Allah is not accusative. Because always remember, Allah will never ever wrong anyone. وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ, Allah will not wrong anyone. And by just calling you la tazni, there is a possibility that you do it, when in fact you don't do at all. So Allah puts it in the third pronoun, so that alhamdulillah. Now, the one where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a direct command, and that command is وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا, and do not approach الزِّنَا. And when you look at the translations of what they say here, they always translate it and they say, and do not come near to adultery. إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. This is in Surah Al-Isra 17, and the ayah is 32. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to understand by this is, He doesn't say do not approach zina, because zina is not a statue. And zina does not mean the source of zina, women or women men. And this is where we become all sick in the mind, is that every time a man speaks to a woman, we get all paranoid. Oh, sex is going to happen. Oh, zina is going to happen. And Muslims, we can't look at each other in the eyes without thinking sex. Do you know why? Because of the wrong belief that contradicts the Quran. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Quran, when He speaks about people, He speaks, مَا مِن نَجْوَ ثَلَثَةٍ إِلَّا وَهُوَ رَابِعُهُمْ, where there are three people, Allah is their fourth. If there are fourth people, Allah is their fifth. And more than that, i.e. 6, 7, 8, every time, 100 people, Allah is their 101st. And then He says, وَلَا أَقَلَّ مِن ذَلِكَ وَلَا أَكْثَرَ, less than that, if you are by yourself, who is with you? Allah. Now, if you are with a woman, you are two. Who is your third? In the hadith, it says shaitan. But the Quran, it says it is Allah. But because we Muslims, we have taken it upon ourselves not to believe in the Quran, as we said, the third one is the shaitan. And every time a man and a woman, when they are together, they both of them at the very same time, they are thinking at subconscious level that a shaitan is here and sex is going to happen. That's why you find the most agitated, the most disturbed people are Muslims when they meet each other. Well, I've seen men meeting English people or American people, a guy meeting other ladies, relaxed. I've seen Muslim women meeting non-Muslim guys, they are relaxed. Muslim man, Muslim women meet, it's babies flying out of the window. It's unbelievable. Wallahi, we are so primitive. And I pray to Allah that you're not. And if you've been listening to my talks by now, you are, by all means, you're not primitive at all. But how many of us are still primitive out there? So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not approach zina, wala taqrabu zina, what He is actually saying to us subhanahu wa ta'ala is this: do not approach with your looks, your words, the way you speak, your senses, your money, your belongings, your Islam, everything. Do not use that to gain access to other people's private parts, and either man to woman or woman to a man. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا, with your action. Don't do things and you intend with what you are doing to actually get into the other parts underwear. And it is this statement and other likes it that are in the Quran that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam acted upon in his time. And when he said that women who go to a salat should not put on perfume, because he sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew that when a woman puts on perfume and heads to the masjid, her scent is going to go all over town, especially in an environment there was no pollution back then. No cars, no, nothing burning. And perfume is smelled by all people. And that, as I said, gives all the wrong impression. And people might interpret that as an invitation to sexual encounter. And then it will encourage people to go and chat up women and the rest of it. And as we know, my sisters and my brother, this statement and other likes that the Prophet ﷺ acted upon were relevant to his time, to his place, and any other places or times that fulfill his conditions. And as we know, humans are very keen to appear attractive and sexy, so much so that sexiness has become a very salient term. You have sexy cars, sexy televisions, sexy glasses, and even sexy slippers, to name but few. So, at a subconscious level, everything we do is sexually motivated. Even if it is primarily we think we are doing what we are doing for whatever we are doing it for, but at subconscious level, we act based on our sexual instinct. The moment you open your eyes, what I wear, to how I smell, to how you walk into a place, how you talk to people, how you buy a coffee, and why you buy the clothes you buy, and everything you do, at subconscious level, there is an element of sex drive behind it. And Allah knows this. As I said earlier on, doesn't He know that? Ala ya'lamu man khalaq? Doesn't He know what He has created? Of course He knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made that the messenger is the best one, as the most fit to implement the wishes and commands of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And I'm talking about the messengers and prophets. And prophets, one day one of you asked me about, are there messengers women? And I said no. But the question should have been, are there messenger women and prophets? Now, when it comes to the part of the messenger for man, yes. Women, there are no messenger women. But are they prophet women? And the answer is yes. There have been prophets that are women. And I'll cover this, inshallah, later on. So back in time, at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and before wearing perfume was made like a normal practice, it was just the realm of couple. And it only meant what couples did it, and mostly women. This is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in one of the hadith, when he talked about al-jum'ah, that anyone who goes to al-jum'ah should put on some perfume, and if they don't have perfume, they should borrow from their wives, because women, that is women. Not a woman not wearing perfume is not in her femininity. Allah says, "Awaman yunashsha'u fil hilya." Al-hilya, have you seen the one who is brought up in beautification? Women love beautification. We men don't care about our nails. We don't care about tons of other things because it's the way we are wired, our brain. That's how Allah created us. Women, men, girls are more savvy. They are more into their physique than boys, and we can never beat women. So women are asking a woman not to wear perfume, asking a woman not to dress nicely, asking a woman not to feel sexy is like asking a dog not to bark. It is impossible. It is impossible. My dear sisters and my brothers, those people who are who couldn't bury a woman just because Islam prohibits it, are doing everything in their position to bury women in their real life. And let me tell you something here. When Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam implemented the law that Allah says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا, do not with your actions do anything that would lead you to zina, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam taught his people at his time that after Salat al-Isha, that is a very dodgy moment, don't do that. Daytime, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not have a military police that walked around town, and anyone who smelled, they would take him to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It is impossible. And again, my dear sisters and my brothers, never ever forget that the reward on your actions primarily comes because of your intentions. Listen to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala establishes a universal truth that is valid today in this life and in the hereafter when we die. Allah says in Surah Al-Qiyamah, and that is the Surah number 75, بَلِ الْإِنسَانُ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ بَصِيرَةٌ, but indeed man, and this man and woman, is well aware of themselves. وَلَوْ أَلْقَى مَعَاذِيرَهُ, even if he, she presents their excuses. You can give me all kinds of excuses today and I don't know what's hidden in your heart. But deep inside you, you know exactly why you are doing what you are doing. And that is what Allah will ask you about on Judgment Day. And this ayah here is what Rasulullah ﷺ explained to us. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَادَ, that the outcome of actions depends on the intentions. So my sister, I will tell you this. Why you wear perfume is your own personal choice. Do not let anyone else tell you otherwise. You know exactly why. Don't listen to these scholars that they say that the Muslim woman that goes to the masjid should go tafilat. Tafilat meaning without any perfume. And others, they say a woman should smell bad when she goes out. Subhanallah, al-haq, it's unbelievable. So if you want to wear perfume, my sister, wear perfume. The reason why you wear perfume is only known to you. If you are going to wear perfume to seek attention and pull guys or provoke them sexually and things like that, then Allah will hold you responsible and you will pay for that. But if, subhanAllah al-haq, you wear a nice perfume just because it makes you feel good, perfume. Sometimes when I'm working and I smell my perfume, you can't imagine the surge, the high spirit that I get because of the nice smell that I have there. Why are you deprived from it? Why are you always accused as being the source of temptation? Why isn't it man that is the source of temptation? Why? Why is it woman? You see, in my brain, when Allah creates us 50-50 and He made us equal, each one of us has got their functions, I don't understand why is a woman source of evil. Yahi, woman is created the way she is created by Allah who created her, and she doesn't have a say in her creation. Women do not have a say in their creation. Even those bush women, the women who act like guys, tough guys, she still is a woman, and you can see it even if her attitude is a woman. Just like a man who acts effeminate is, guess what? Is a man no matter how many teeth he grows. And also, my dear sisters and my brothers, especially for guys, I'm not talking about the Bedouins of Saudi Arabia or anyone who has been educated in their universities. And I've seen some English people, when they become Muslim and they go to Saudi Arabia to study, they come back here like a Bedouin who was born, subhanAllah, he's a Bedouin, but he's born here, his parents are English, he grew up in England, but the 3 years that they took him to brainwash him into the Wahhabis thinking, they come back here so narrow-minded, you would not believe that this person at one point in their existence has existed in Europe. I was brought up in Europe. You can't imagine. Al-Islam in England is run by the losing team of the scholars in Saudi Arabia. What? Listen to me in this one, because it makes my blood boil. If they say in Saudi Arabia, Salafism is the best way, the truth, blah, 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 right? It's the worst country in the world when it comes in everything that humans are measured by. Administrative performance, they are the worst. Human rights, they are the worst. Women rights, are there women in Saudi Arabia? I don't know if female there. But anyway, let's assume that are female in Saudi Arabia, they have the worst right. Kids, you can't let your kid out of a leash because people will steal it and they will take the child away. Homosexuality is widely spread in Saudi Arabia than you can give credit for. Atheism is far spread in Saudi Arabia. Poverty? Women in Saudi Arabia, in Riyadh and places, are working as hookers because they can't feed their children and father died. And because a woman who's lost her father and is a widow, people don't marry her. And now they are working as hookers in Riyadh in Saudi Arabia. What talking to me about? What, it's only in books, Salafism and the righteous people. Where is the righteousness in Saudi Arabia? Why do we want to export this Islam, the losing version of Islam, to the world? Why can't we just go back to the book of Allah, ya akhi? How much would Allah need to make perfume haram on women? This, I will tell you of an experience. I've lived this experience myself. Back in time, I think like 15, 16, 17 years ago, my brain is not working math-wise right now. My wife then and I went to Saudi Arabia for Hajj. When we got to the airport, I presented our European passports, and my wife being back then a blonde lady, the man behind the counter, the custom guy, took my passport, looked at me, and then he took the passport of my wife then. And he looked at her, and he looked at her face, and then he looked at the passport, and he kept looking at my wife. Face, passport. And I thought to myself, how many times do you need to look at this? My wife was not wearing a niqab or any kind of that female controlling techniques. She was just faced normal, you know, wearing something on her head, hijab, you know. And he kept looking, and then he turned to his friend, and I saw him, and my wife also then saw him. And he turned to his friend, and he pointed to my wife's passport, and then he winked with his eyes to my wife. And I looked at him, and I told him like that. I said, do you want me to give her to you? I said, you can have her. And he looked at me like, are you joking? Are you serious? And then my wife held my hand, and she goes, please just keep down and normal and things like that. These people are perverts. And then after Hajj, we went to a shop to buy something, and the guy, wallahi al-azim, I had to fight for my wife. I had to stay. He was getting too close to her. He wanted to touch her. And I said to him, ya akhi, what's wrong with you? And the man, I couldn't believe the thinking behind this. What is he thinking? Like, what? And you want me to believe the fatwa about women from these perverts? What's wrong? My dear sisters and my brothers, if you want to wear perfume, my sister, wear it. Wallahi, wear it. You are not doing anything wrong except with what goes in your heart. Sometimes we are on the train and a woman walks in, and I think it's like Debenhams fragrance store walked in. It's so strong, her perfume. And it makes me like wanna puke. And then you go, what's wrong with that? We men, we do not carry our private parts in our nose. Perfume, yes, it's erotic when nicely used with the mood and everything. I've never seen men in the street in London walking erect just because women are wearing perfume. Never seen that. I've never seen that in my entire... As a matter of fact, women in the streets, like, we've got bras, we've got mannequins, we've got things. What do you call them? The things... I forgot how they call them. Well, they put the clothes on and things like that. Just women in bras and underwear and Ann Summers. I've never seen any man having an erection just because of these things. Subhanallah. But bring the people of Saudi Arabia and watch them. And I see them in Oxford Street. We see them, and we see how much money they splash out here. So the final thought about the whole thing, my sister, is this. There is not a strong, authentic, agreed upon hadith that prohibits a woman from wearing perfume. Moderation, responsibility, and sensibility as a woman, you already know this. You don't want to put yourself in difficult situations. If a Muslim woman, and I've seen them, if a Muslim woman and she is, you get on the train and you smell good, you leave a good impression on the people around you. There is that level of perfume that you can wear. And no perfume, it's kind of like an aroma, like you smell it, you get aroused sexually. It doesn't happen like that, okay? And people who think like that, they have not really experienced, not women and no perfume. But if you you wear your perfume, wear it nicely, sensibly and sensitively and responsibly, and go. I'd rather you leave a good impression on someone who you met on the train, on a bus, and you're wearing your hijab, as opposed to you stinking and sweaty, and someone will get, say, these Muslims not only are freaks in the mind, but they also stink and they are smelly. Okay? This is one. The intention why you wear perfume is in your heart, and as such, it's between you and Allah alone. Don't let anyone else come between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wearing perfume for a woman could be as benign as wearing a pair of shoes. She doesn't want any attention, she just wears it and she goes, she likes it, and that's the end of that, okay? And it could be as detrimental and as killer as an expressive piece of lingerie. It's entirely up to you, my sister, and always remember, on Judgment Day, Allah will ask you about your choices and why you chose to do what you did, and He will not ask you in which hadith you found that, because on Judgment Day it's only Quran and you. So my sisters, enjoy your perfume, wear the perfume, and every time you put your perfume and you feel yourself liberated, do make dua for me. I pray to Allah, my dear sisters and my brothers, especially sisters, that this talk here has brought some smile on your face, some joy, and so now you can go and shop for some nice perfume for yourself. And if you have any questions, please do get back to me. I have covered the talk from different issues, from different angles, and I try to keep it as small as possible, but it's impossible to keep it contained. And I could speak for hours, but what I've said is more than enough. If you have any more questions, please do get back to me. My name is Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. My telephone number is 078-76-40-8735. And enjoy your life. You deserve a life of enjoyment as well. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.